عملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to him, and peace and blessings be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He who is guided by the will of Allah, no one can misguide him, and he who is misguided, no one can guide him except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، واجعل التفرق بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تدع فينا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم امين. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. We are still dealing with the details of the battle of Uhud. Last time we highlighted something has to do with the most important title of the battle of Uhud, which is the obedience of the commandments. The obedience of the authority. At that time, it was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly. Directly. He gave directions. He said, do and don'ts. And he was very specific. He asked the archers not to leave their places. Subhanallah, they made the mistake. By Allah's will, Allah made them taste some kind of the punishment. This is a big test for us. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself does not exist, but we have the law that Allah sent through Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. As if Allah is teaching us the divine laws, divine commandments, divine directions. When someone of us on an individual level, small group level, community level, umma level, we break the law, we will be punished. Are you with me? This could be understood in another big title. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Anyone who decides to forsake, to leave, to forget, to ignore, to delete from his calculations the divine directions, the authority should be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I decide the authority in my life is not for Allah, because by the way, none of us, I mean human beings, not Muslims, none of us, but has an authority in his life. It's impossible not to have it. Impossible. Give me one example on earth that someone is enjoying the full 100% freedom and he is not under any kind of authority of law on earth. One example. At any country, there is something has an authority upon you. Legal, traffic law, money law, banking law, family law, whatever it is. Don't tell me I'm a free. No, Habib, no, not a free. Even if you are a man and you can beat anyone on the street, if your wife decided to go to the court, may Allah be with you. Thakratka ummuk. Authority or not authority? Seriously, I'm not joking. Wallahi. You have an authority. Any police man at any country stops you by law. If you refuse to stop, if he wants to use the authority against you, may Allah be with you. True or false? Can you have full freedom not stop by the traffic light sign? No, there's an authority against you. Whatever it is. So for us, the authority number one is for Allah. This is simply, it's very clear for us. As if we understand the meaning, when they broke the commandment of Muhammad sallallahu Allah made them aware, what does it mean? This happened with us last time. Now we are still continuing like we did in the Battle of Badr. We have some details. And the main reason, as I told you, it's not just to have more information. I'm doing, inshallah, by the will of Allah, I'm doing my best to relate. Because one of the main reasons why we educate ourselves with the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that we can relate to apply in our daily life. Or otherwise, I don't think any one of you has enough time to entertain. Any one of us, including myself, we can have better entertainment places. Don't you think so? Any movie film made by Hollywood with top high technology is much more powerful in entertainment than listening to just information. No. We listen to this information because it's part of our identity. We need them. They are like the lights, guidance. Happen there. Okay, this will keep repeating as the divine law. سنة كونية. That's why Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, فقصص القصص لعلهم يتفكرون. Tell them the stories. Narrate to them. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم so that they might reflect upon. Prophet Muhammad himself was in need for the stories of the previous prophets. He himself. لنثبت به فؤادك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad that one of the divine wisdom reasons behind why he keeps giving him the information gradually and about the specific stories of previous prophets, قال لنثبت به فؤادك. To give you the tranquility, to fix down, to help you to settle in your mission. The same thing, Prophet Muhammad's seerah for us, لنثبت our أفئدة. So that we can settle down, we can make sure to have peace and tranquility that we are in the right track. We have the guidance. It's like وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. You know the difference between a believer with genuine, uncorrupted revelation and a believer with being disconnected from the revelation. Because we have believers, but they are disconnected. They used to be. They don't have valid books anymore. We are still, alhamdulillah, Allah, it's not because of us, Allah preserved. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَأَنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. To know the importance of your existence. Are you, we, facing troubles? Yes. Disasters? Yes. Difficulties? Yes. Obstacles? Yes. But we know the exit. And we know how to escape the obstacles because of we have the manual. لله المثل. It's like any engineer. There's a big trouble in the factory, but full peace of mind because he has the guidance from the main office. What to do, how to do it, why to do, why not to do, and full support. 24/7. لله المثل الأعلى. Hotline. Whatever. Hello. Okay. Yes. No. No. Okay. Regardless, even if everything is destroyed, as long as I'm following the commandment, whatever happens, it's not my responsibility. They know, it's like you working with a big, big company, giant companies, okay? As long as you are doing your job according to the book, no fear. But what if it's not your problem? Someone superior in charge is in charge. It's not your problem. Do you know this feeling? This is exactly how we should be feeling. We are not responsible to fix everything on earth because we can't. But we must keep striving to fix as much as we can on earth. And this is our test. طب, why do I need this seer or this something? Why, the guidance. How shall I do? What should, oh, be careful. The fact that you are a believer and you are an Arab and you know the Quran does not mean you have granted for granted, خلاص, do whatever. And no. يا نساء النبي لستنك أحد من النساء. Okay. The wife of Prophet Muhammad said, if someone made a sin, يضاعف لها العذاب. The fact that you are the wife of Prophet Muhammad does not mean you have like a open check, white check, خلاص. No. Be careful. You've been honored by being a wife. So therefore, the responsibility is double. So we have the same thing. We have the guidance, yes. We know what should be done, yes. Is there anyone on earth who does not know how to solve the problem of humanity in drugs, toxicants, prostitution, porno? We know. We have it. We have the law, the justification, the power, the alternative. It's there. Okay, what's my job? Apply it. Keep talking about it. Try to convince as much as we can, to convince them to apply it. Is there any full guarantee that I will succeed? No. يأتي النبي يوم القيامة ومعه الرجل ويأتي النبي ومعه الرجلان ويأتي النبي وليس معه أحد. Prophets, not normal people like us. Some of them, they will come on the day of judgment having just one follower, two followers, some of them no followers. A prophet. And he receives directly the revelation, not like us. We are just believers now. We submitted. We don't have direct connection with Allah. Jibril did not talk with any one of us. Some of the prophets in the history whom they received the honor of Allah and they received Jibril directly, no one believed in them.
What?
Yes. So what's my job? Fulfill my duty as much as I can. Results? No accountability. But the good thing that we have, I'm just giving you the justification of the importance of knowing the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to know the Quran and the seerah. In light of this, we understand the concept of obedience. When they broke the commandments, said, don't leave that place, protect our back, the archers. And subhanAllah, you know, Khan Walid radiallahu anhu, he just picked, he's a professional fighter. Khan Walid, to the best of my knowledge, he was not defeated, never ever in his life, neither when he was a non-believer or when he became a believer. No one defeated him ever in a battle in his life. La ilaha illallah. That's why one of the amazing wisdoms behind the fact that when he passed away normally in his bed, not in a battle. SubhanAllah. And he said the very important proverb or statement attributed to him. He said, قال ما في جسدي قال في جسدي بضعة وثمانون ضربة من سيف وطعنة من رمح ورمية من سهم وها أنا أموت على فراشي كما يموت البعير فلا نامت أعين الجبناء. The idea, he was as if saying, you know, I have a lot of, you know, strikes by swords on my body, because hundreds and tens of battles in his life. Many people, they, you know, they stabbed him with their spears. Many people, they hit him with their, you know, they threw him with the arrows. Or he received a lot of strikes by, you know, by the swords, tens, thousands of times, which is a lot of injuries and cuts in his body. I'm dying on my bed like the camel, كما يموت البعير, which means I'm not a shaheed in the battlefield. Some of the scholars, they were commenting on this. They say, subhanAllah, what could be the divine wisdom behind the fact that Sayfullah al-Maslul, the sword of Allah, as he was called, passed away on his bed? One of the amazing answers, they said, Allah did not want to give the honor to anyone to say that I broke the sword of Allah. لن يكون الشرف لأحد يقول أنا قتلت سيف الله المسلول. It's Allah who took him. اطلع برا. No one has to interfere. This is سيف الله. سبحان الله. Sometimes you look, but why? Who told you he's not a martyr? سبحان الله. But the point, obedience. طيب. Today we will be highlighting the following narrations from the صحيح السيرة. Now, اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. Message number one. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Sorry, was it? Okay. Now we will see some. Oh, by the way, I'm picking and choosing because the details are lot of details. If I want to go through every single thing I read, I mean we need maybe 1,000 session. I'm picking and choosing what could be suitable to the audience in terms of the limitation of time and the age groups that I'm sitting with. Plus, I'm speaking in English, not in Arabic. Now, we will know something about Anas bin al-Nadr radiyallahu anhu. Anas bin Malik says, عمي الذي سميت به لم يشهد مع رسول الله بدرا. You know, Anas bin Malik, he is the servant of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His uncle name is Anas ibn al-Nadr. His father, which is Malik ibn al-Nadr, named his son after Anas ibn al-Nadr. Okay? The mother of Anas ibn Malik name is Ummu Sulaym. Just to know, okay? But Anas ibn Malik is talking about Anas ibn al-Nadr, which is his uncle. He says, قال عمي الذي سميت به لم يشهد مع رسول الله بدرا. My uncle whom I was named after did not participate in the battle of Badr. Now the title that we will be discussing, sincerity and to be honest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sincerity, ikhlas, صدق. Truthfulness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, the Battle of Badr, if you remember, no one knew that it will happen as it happened. And no one was planning aslan. وتودون أن غير ذات الشوكة تنول لكم وإذ يعدكم الله إحدى الطائفتين because they were directing all of their plans towards the caravan to bring back part of the their money that has been taken by the مشركين. الله سبحانه وتعالى by his will أبو سفيان managed to escape with the caravan. Then he sent to أبو جهل, don't proceed, go back to Mecca. وكفى الله من الاختلال. No one can, our money is saved. Abu Jahl insisted to come and fight, and he said the very famous statement. He said, قال لا والله حتى نأتي ماء بدر ونشرب الخمر وتضرب لنا القيان أو تغني لنا القيان وتسمع بنا العرب. Abu Jahl insisted to go, okay, even if we will not fight, we will go to the what's supposed to be the location of the battle, and we will drink alcohol, and we will let our female slaves, you know, dance and sing for us, so that every single person in the Arabic peninsula hear about our might and power. Do you know the arrogance? Subhanallah. Allah was pulling him to his final destiny, subhanallah. We know that. Now, because of that group was not planning to go to fight, so many of the very sincere Sahaba, they did not go with them because just the group of people can manage. It's just a normal mission. It's not a big mission. It's not something thought that they will have this kind of fight and shahada fi sabilillah. One of those, Anas ibn al-Nadr. Now, Anas ibn Malik is telling us about what was happening in the heart and in the intention of his uncle, Anas ibn al-Nadr. So Anas ibn Malik says, Ammi, my uncle, that I was named after, لم يشهد, he did not participate, he did not witness Badr with Rasulullah. فشق عليه. It was very hard on his heart. How come I'm not there? I was not fighting. How come I did not, you know, I was maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted me as a shaheed, as a martyr. قال فشق عليه قال أول مشهد شهده رسول الله غيبت عنه. What was very difficult on his heart, that the first time Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is facing his enemy, I'm not there. غيبت عنه, I was missed. So it was very difficult for him, as if he's accusing himself that, okay, maybe you are not that sincere in your intention. He was accusing himself. قال غيبت عنه وإن أراني الله مشهدا فيما بعد مع رسول الله لا يراني الله ما أصنع. He used an Arabic proverb of like an oath. He say, by Allah, if Allah willed and enabled me to witness something in the future with Prophet Muhammad, Allah will see what I will do. It's like an Arabic rhetorical expression and like an oath, like a covenant. I will prove to myself and to my Lord, you know, what kind of love that I have this religion and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, Anas ibn Malik continues. قال فهاب أن يقول غيرها. And خلاص, the gym stopped. He wanted to say more. I said خلاص. And I'm not trying to show off, but I feel really very difficult. How come I did not witness it? But ya Allah, I will let you witness from me what I will do if you enable me to witness it again. It's as if someone is challenging himself with his sincerity. قال فشهد مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم أحد. He was there in the battle of Uhud. And don't forget that in the battle of Uhud we have two big horrible incidents. Number one, the withdrawal of the munafiqeen. Do you remember? They were 1,000. Can you imagine? An army that represents this new state, 1,000. All of a sudden, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he declared, you know, buyutuna awra, we have a problem, I'm sorry. Third of the army. You're talking about 300 out of 1,000. Look to the psychological defeat now, you know, inside. Third of the army just disappears. This gives you, you know, the fear. So that was the first challenge. Second challenge, what happened when everything was changed and the archers, they left the place, because at a certain point someone screamed Muhammad Qad qutil. It was like a rumor. For a moment, someone thought that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was killed. No one knew who said it, but someone said it, Muhammad qutil. So a chaos happened at that time. So some Sahaba, they lost hope. They just stayed in their places. If he died, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I'm what supposed to do? Let them kill me. You see? Now, some people, they said, قُمْ فَقُمْ. Look what Anas ibn al-Nadr did at that time. قال فشهد مع رسول يوم أحد. قال فاستقبل سعد بن معاذ فقال له أنس يا أبا عمر أين. So سعد بن معاذ saw أنس بن النضر. He said where are you going. قال واها لريح الجنة أجده دون أحد. واها, it's like, you know, I don't have to say it in English. I'd say wow, I'm able to smell the smell of the Jannah behind Uhud. Like a metaphor, which if, you know, he started having the feeling that I'm approaching, I'm just one step prayer to go to the Jannah. Which means it's like a sign of sincerity. قال واهن لريح الجنة إني أجد ريحها دون أحد. As if I'm smelling this, it's a metaphor. It's to give you the assurance that this is my final destination, which means it's a sign of I do not have not 1000% single hesitation in my decision. This is a metaphorical expression to show I can see the Jannah, I can smell the Jannah, which means خلاص, final decision. I'm going there to fight, to defeat the enemy who are coming to try to kill us and to get rid of us and to hurt Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال فقاتلهم حتى قتل. He kept on fighting till he was killed. Now they say فوجد في جسده, here comes the point. قال فوجد في جسده 84 من بين ضربة وطعنة ورمية. He was hit about 80 plus strike of a sword, stabbed by a spears, and he was thrown with the arrows. قال فقالت أخته عمتي الربيع بنت النضر فما عرفت أخي إلا ببنانه. He was attacked badly to a degree no one was able to recognize this body belongs to whom except his sister الربيع from his thumb. From his thumb she knew that it's him. There was a sign on his, this part of his body, his thumb. He said, oh, it's him. His face was completely khalas, you know. They cut him into pieces. This gives you an idea, you know, because maybe we are not able to imagine this because nowadays wars, you know, they just boom, boom, exploded. You could see. At that time, it was a one-to-one person fighting. So sometimes you might have received a big injury, still there, keep fighting. He's bleeding, keep fighting. Some of them, he might, his part of his body, for example, his arm is cut, and they keep fighting. That Sahabi, in the Battle of Mu'tah, I forgot his name, Amr ibn al-Jumuh, I think, if I'm not mistaken. You know, the one who was holding the flag, just for your information, part of that Amr ibn al-Jumuh, I think. عبد الله بن رواحة؟ الله يجزيكم خير. عمرو الجموح is the one with the عرجة. قال لطعنا الجنة بعرجتي هذه. عبد الله بن رواحة جزاكم الله خير. I mean the idea, flag, it was, you know, the flag at the battle which gives you identity. As long as it's still up and everyone can see it, it means we are not defeated yet. That's why the most important protection system in the battle, it was to protect the flag. Because the flag was the sign whether the army is still fighting or they were conquered. So one of the Sahaba, he was holding, someone chopped his arm. He held with the other one, they chop from here and here. So he was bleeding, yet with this part of his body, he was, you know, hugging the flag. I mean, there's no time, oh, okay, but I have pain, no. It's a matter because if the flag goes down, it means the army is finished. This is that. Oh, so each army always has he's fighting. He's looking to the flag. Are we still fighting? Well, we are finished. Subhanallah. So that's why we need to imagine this, because we don't see these things in this time, except in the movies, طبعا. قال فوجد في جسده بضع وثمانون من بين ضربة وطعنة ورمية. قال فقالت أخته عمة الربيع فما عرفت أخي إلا ببنانه. ونزلت هذه الآية. Now in this context they received this ayah. قال فكانوا يرون أنها نزلت فيه وفأصحابه. What is the ayah? They said this ayah, we believe that it was applicable on Anas ibn al-Nadr and anyone similar, because this incident was not the only incident. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his life about 67 to 70 battles between Sariya and Ghazwa. Hunayn, Badr, Uhud, Dhat al-Riqa', Tabuk, Mu'ta. Some one of them he was participating and some of them he was not. So we are talking about tens of incidents, about 70. So we have a very, very wonderful stories about how honest they were. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed about this incident. قال من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا. Among the believers are men who have proven true to what they pledged to Allah. We go back to the hadith. What was his pledge, his covenant, his promise? قال لئن أشهدني الله مشهدا ليراني الله ما أصنع. He made like a covenant, Ya Allah. Because by the way, we all do this in our lives. We say, Ya Allah, if you gave me money, if you gave me a wife, if you gave me a son, if you gave me a job, if you gave me money, I will do something. We do it. Ya Allah, if you give me something. But not every single person of us, when Allah gives him the opportunity, will prove his, you know, fulfill his promise. It happens. May Allah protect all of us. Especially in the context of money. Millions of believers, they keep begging Allah for money. Ya Allah, I want to build an orphanage. Ya Allah, I will help all my relatives. I will support all of them. Ya Allah, I will support all the masajid in my neighborhood. Ya Allah. Okay, Allah gave him. He became multimillionaire. Even the zakah, he's not paying. Forget the normal sadaqah, even the zakah. Hardly you can reach him to ask him even for his zakah. It happens. Not everyone. That's why we keep asking, Ya Allah, ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. Ya Allah, help us to prove our promise. Allah is testing us. So Anas ibn al-Nadr, he was part of this ayah. من المؤمنين رجال. Among the believers are men who have proven it true to what they pledged to Allah. And by the way, this ayah is applicable to every single person of us in any promise we made a covenant between us, ourselves and Allah. And I think everyone has his own story. Some of us, for example, they're very quick. Practical example. Any one of us could have been in a very difficult situation 15 years ago because he used to have a very sick son. Ya Allah, give him the cure. Ya Allah, heal him. Ya Allah, and I will prove to be طيب. Imagine at that time, this person, he or she, was not praying for Allah, was not fulfilling the covenant of Allah in prayer, and he promised, Ya Allah, well, okay, his son, mashallah, has a good health now. The last time he prayed the Fajr in Ramadan. We forget. We have this kind of weakness points. Money, prayer, the hijab. How many sisters I met in my life through the discussion with my students, because, you know, I'm a university lecturer, so I meet thousands of those people. I met hundreds of cases. She keeps postponing wearing the hijab and you make a promise, Ya Allah help me in the tawjihi. You know the tawjihi? The Jordanian tawjihi, do you know what does it mean? The biggest disasters for Jordanians. The horrible nightmare. Wallahi. Yani, it's the high school, you know? The high school test. Jordanians, as if they are facing death. every single family as if they are prepared to meet the angel of death because of the high school graduation. It's amazing. Anyway, many people at that time, thousands of us, we Jordanians, they make a list of promises with Allah. The same thing. Yeah, because it's Allah subhanAllah, it's a cultural issue anyway, but it's one of the difficult times. Even the families, they announce for all the relatives, don't visit us. We will not welcome anyone. No invitations, no meals, no visits, no weddings, nothing. Wallahi, as if it's a preparation for war. Ah, yes, tawjihi. This is in Palestine and Jordan. I mean, why I'm mentioning? Because the same? You have the same situation. I mean, why I'm mentioning this? Because millions of us, at that time, we make big promises with Allah. Ya Rab, help me in tawjihi. Ya Allah, just such and such, you know, the great something. I will start wearing the hijab. I will pray. I will be obedient to my parents. I will go to the masjid. I will stop smoking. What is the percentage of those who fulfill their promise? You can see them in the university. She keeps postponing the hijab till her fifth child is married. Then she's postponing, Ya Allah, I will. Bas Ya Rab, jawwiz ibni, al-khamis. She started asking the support of Allah at the tawjihi. She's still thinking to fulfill her promise in wearing the hijab till or when her fifth child is married, or at least with one child, grandson. Well, by Allah, inshallah, I will wear the hijab. I mean, most of us, we have this problem. That's why we need to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising those people. من المؤمنين رجال. صدقوا. And by the way, when you say رجال, it's an example because in Arabic language, يوزع على التغليب. It's for common. But it's applicable on men and women. سمية رضي الله عنها أول شهيدة في الإسلام. The biggest honor, the first martyr in the history of Islam is for a woman. The first supporter for the greatest prophet, who? Khadija radiallahu anha, a woman. Yes. قَالْ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا. They have proven true to what they pledged to Allah. Some of them have fulfilled their pledge with their lives. Others are waiting their turn. Very beautiful ayah, by the way. God is that Allah knows, Allah is watching, Allah is waiting for your fulfillment. Nafid. If you pass the exam, alhamdulillah. They have never changed their commitment in the least. لاحظ فمنهم من قضى نحبه خلاص fulfilled وانتهى their lives. قال ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدل. We have not changed. Still waiting. Allah knows. Because Allah decides when the test will happen. Now, let me finish by this, today's session. Now, one of the morals of the story, which is the wisdom behind it, that if you made a pledge, covenant between you and Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-kareem, the most generous, will not leave you to stray. And Allah will help you. But the point, here's the secret in the formula. No one knows the time of the test. Yani you and me, we are supposed to work like the fire workers. You know fire workers? What is their attitude while they are on duty? Stand by all the time. Stand by. Fully equipped. They have everything on their bodies. Once they heard, you know, I don't know what they hear, you know, a bell that rang or a sign or something, just immediately they go to this special equipped car. In seconds, خلاص, ready. I'm ready. This is how, you know, like the for example, the emergency nurses, emergency doctors, the ambulance driver, the firework, all of those people, the main idea of their identity is stand by people. This is how the believer should be in terms of, I make the pledge, I do my best, once the exam comes, I'm ready. And by the way, be sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not leave any of us. If you are honest, Allah will support you in the test. God, and by the way, we don't all have the same test. Some people will be tested in their bodies. Some people will be tested in their money. Some people will be tested in their families. And we have now, for example, the millions in Palestine and in Gaza. Many of them, they lost every single member of their families and their properties. Yes, ومنهم ما ينتظر. We have others now, somewhere here and there, they are tested in their money. Do they support or not? The help and needy and poor. We have others, they are tested in their power, support, media and politics. And many of them, they failed. Alhamdulillah. Yes, they failed. You know what I'm saying, Alhamdulillah? Because many of them, they are hypocrites. If they played the dirty role that they are supporting, we will lose understanding of the reality. Allah does not want فَأَحْبَطَهُمْ Allah does not want them to support. Because He wants us, Allahu A'lam, to witness who is with that group and to witness who is with that group, which is the fulfillment of قول الله تعالى مَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيَذَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَى مَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى يَمِيزَ الْخَبِيثَ مِنَ الطَّيِّبِ Allah would not have left the believers on the condition they are until he distinguished between good and evil. Huh? Yes. Yes. Yes, exactly. One of the biggest wisdoms of Allah, Allah is distinguishing. Allah's will is pushing humanity to be distinguished, which means don't keep playing behind the mask. Yalla Habibi. Take off the mask. Show your reality. Come, yalla, look at the surface. Show the reality. Show your reality, your reality. After that, every single person on earth is able to realize who is who. So what's next? Take a decision, Habib Albi, with whom you want to be. This is what I call Iqamat al-Hujjah, which is what? Establishing the argument, which means when I stand before Allah on the Day of Judgment, Ya Allah, I did not know. You know. Ya Allah, I did not hear. You heard. Ya Allah, I was not able to realize. Ya Habibi. Ya Habibi, how come? Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, that we had very strong examples like Piers Morgan, قدس الله سره. For example. Yes. Yes, directly you can see. How many copy of Piers Morgan on earth we have? Do you want to tell me that Piers does not know? Does not understand? Come on. By the way, I'm not discussing now Muslims and non-Muslims. Because we have among Muslims a lot of hypocrites. صحيح لله. This is one of the important meanings of صدق مع أهده. منهم من قضى ومنهم من ينتظر. We don't know our final destination, but we can plan for it, inshallah. We can plan for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, والعياذ بالله, subhanahu wa ta'ala does not play this kind of dirty games with us. If he gives a promise, you are dealing with subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he told you, do this and this, I promise with this. خلاص, that's it. There's no possibility, والعياذ بالله, that after doing everything, خلاص, a surprise, I was cheating, أعوذ بالله. I do it with you do it with me as a human beings. Allah does not do this. If Allah promised you the Jannah once, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا وَتَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ نُزُلًا مِّنْ غَفُورٍ رَّحِيمٍ وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِّمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Very beautiful ayats. Anyway, جزاكم الله خير. See you tomorrow in the tafsir session, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. أخ عبد الله موجود؟ أخ عبد الله صاحب الموعد موجود؟